But let's begin in 1932, a pivotal moment in Irish democracy, and the moment, indeed, at which our parliamentary democracy was secured. Because those who had been defeated in the Civil War had regrouped politically as Fianna Fáil, and only 9 years after Civil War defeat took power and authority over the army, the Gardaí, and the public service. We begin then with that 1932 election.
I have just tendered to His Excellency the Governor-General advice to dissolve the Oireachtas.
President of the Executive Council of the Irish Free State, W.T. Cosgrave of...
The rights and liberties secured by the treaty must be preserved. The fullest possible advantage must be taken of our membership of the British Commonwealth of Nations and of our proximity to the British market. The government party is the one party in the country which can secure for the people political and economic salvation.
This was still the age of town square public meetings with bonfires blazing and torchlit processions to welcome party leaders to provincial towns.
The meetings were sometimes late, there were bonfires, there was great enthusiasm, but in any case, the contest has taught us to consider all the points that were at issue in the election, and I think that people generally will be satisfied with the result.
But W.T. Cosgrave could not have been happy with the result. He was never to see office again, ceding power to Éamon de Valera.
The programme of Fianna Fáil has now been definitely adopted as the national policy of the Irish people. That programme aims at restoring the unity of Ireland and securing its independence, at placing as many families as possible upon the land.
Another cornerstone of Fianna Fáil policy. Indeed, De Valera was recently on record that a wall could be built around the island of Ireland, and that such was our genius and capacity for self-sufficiency that we could sustain a population of 20 million.
At building up our industries so that the food we eat, the clothes we wear, the houses we live in, the articles in common daily use in the lives of our people may all, as far as is reasonably possible, be produced by Irish labour from Irish material.
And as was usual with Éamon de Valera, acknowledged the interest shown in Irish development since independence by Friends of Ireland abroad.
The Friends of Ireland will rejoice with us that we have seen this day, that, as in the past, they will sustain us with their aid and attend our efforts with their thoughts and prayers.
There was another snap election within 12 months, the 1933 election. De Valera wanted to consolidate his position.
Last November, in the Dáil, I said that it was our intention to give a substantial permanent reduction in the annuities which the farmers were paying. I knew we were going to unite the Irish people and bring together the people marching together in the past, but I didn't think we'd reunite them so quickly as to get Mr. Cosgrave at last to see that the Irish tenant farmer couldn't afford to pay these annuities and send them over to England so easily as he was in the past.
Then he moved on to another Fianna Fáil grievance, the Oath of Allegiance.
You have been already reminded that we said the first act would be to get rid of the Oath of Allegiance. We want to get rid of that oath because it was a fruitful source of division and dissension in this country. The moment we got into office, we put that oath through the door. It was held up by the Senate, but the moment this election is over and we are returned, it will be sent back to the Senate, and whether they like it or not, then it becomes law over their heads.
W.T. Cosgrave was still hopeful of a return to power.
Fianna Fáil got into office last year by promises which they must themselves know were incapable of fulfilment. Now, after 10 months, they have suddenly sprung a general election to the people, pretending that they have performed all that they undertook. If in fact that were true, or if even 100th part of it were true, there need be no election at all, because no good citizen could oppose a government that had done so much in the short space of time as 10 months as Fianna Fáil has claimed.
Fianna Fáil election promises. This was the preocupation of Cumann na Gael in that era. In the 1932 election, they had taken out a full-page advertisement on election day. Mussolini can't do it. The German Chancellor can't do it. The Mikado in Japan can't do it. Solve unemployment. De Valera says he can do it. Send him on a world tour. The world needs him more than we do. Vote Cumann na Gael.
We are engaged in what has been called a war with the British people. That war was started by the muddling bravado of the Fianna Fáil government. Working people are aware that more skill, more ability, more courage, more character are necessary for the conclusion of a fair agreement in the conference chamber than for the making of a wild speech at a street corner.
Those recordings were taken from cinema newsreels of the 1932 and 1933 elections. Radio kept out of the election in those years. And the politicians too, it may be said, were reticent when it came to broadcasting. From the very beginning, their instinct was to, quote, steer clear as far as possible of politics and religion. That was J.J. Walsh, First Minister for Posts and Telegraph, to his secretary in the department, P.S. O'Hegarty, writing as early as 1926. In 1932, a modest proposal had been put to the Broadcasting Advisory Committee, suggesting that some, quote, short speeches or statements by representatives of the various political parties should be broadcast during the general election campaign. And this was duly submitted to the Cumann na Gael government, but with the recommendation that it be rejected. The government was reminded that when the radio service had been launched, it had been decided, quote, to debar the broadcasting of all matter of a controversial political character. It was now desirable to continue with such a policy, quote, in view of the impracticality of exercising any control over the actual matter which might be broadcast and the abuse which might ensue if unrestricted political broadcasts were permitted. Finance Minister Ernest Blythe scarcely needed such discouragement. His own policy was expressed in his decision on this file, quote, I am against political broadcasting.
But we begin this morning with a general election of almost 70 years ago.
Plan of Public Tour is the first real attempt that has been made since the Civil War to raise national affairs out of the rut of party politics and bitterness.
Sean McBride, leader of Plan na Publicta in the 1948 general election.
This is Plan na Publicta calling. Noel Hartnett will now speak. Electors, at last you have an opportunity of expressing your opinion of the mismanagement of the Fianna Fáil regime.
It was Plan na Publicta's success at some by-elections which precipitated the election. De Valera decided to go early.
The government, which has now been in office for 15 years, longer than any other government in Europe, has grown completely indifferent to the well-being and the future security of our people.
This recording from the 1948 election is in the RTE Sound Archive, but I doubt if it comes from an actual broadcast.
As you know, Ireland is now threatened with an evil without parallel in its long, agonized history.
More likely it was used at smaller party meetings, which could not command the presence of Sean McBride or Noel Hartnett.
The old age pensioners, your fathers and mothers, who worked to support you and devoted perhaps 55 years of hard toil to this country, they are given a miserable increase of 2 and sixpence on their 1939 pension of 10 shillings per week. But the ministers of state, the chosen men, award themselves a salary increase of £10 per week and pensions after 7 years in office of £500 per year. In the whole history of democratic government, no greater example can be found of cynical selfishness.
And there are also references to electors in this constituency, which would allow such a recording to be used in any constituency in the country.
What are the achievements of Fianna Fáil in the last 5 years? They have built giant airports with giant runways, but the boys and girls, the cream of our population, still trek to the shabby old mail boat. The land is being stripped of its agricultural workers. The cost of living is daily climbing. The people are gazing on commodities in shop windows which they can no longer afford to buy. These are the crimes of Fianna Fáil, and it is for these crimes that they now ask your confidence and your vote.
And this, remember, from a party which, as its founder Sean McBride had insisted, was dedicated to...
to raise national affairs out of the rut of party politics and betterment.
Indeed. Back to Noel Hartnett. This is how he concluded that particular political speech.
I ask you lastly to honour the sacrifice of those who died for Ireland down the long centuries. I ask you to do this by making Ireland an example to the world of a true Christian community. Plan a public that consists of men and women who in the past have belonged to all parties. It has a welcome for you. I ask you finally to think over what I have said. I ask you to vote for the Clan Republic, the candidates in this constituency. I ask you to turn your backs on the decaying past and to look up to the sky where the sun is again rising. Thank you.
And Clan Republic won 10 seats at that election and entered an inter-party government deeply divided ideologically but willing to unite on one issue, to put De Valera's Fianna Fáil out of office. That inter-party government lasted 3 years. Then Fianna Fáil came back and governed from 1951 to 1954. That was a period when the election campaigns ended not with a major head-to-head televised debate, but with a monster meeting at the GPO in O'Connell Street in Dublin or in College Green.
People of Dublin, as I've said, I am usually sent to the country, if you please, whenever a general election is on.
This is Éamon de Valera, then leader of Fianna Fáil and outgoing Taoiseach at the final rally of the 1954 general election.
But sometimes I'm inclined to kick over the traces when some of the organisers of the election campaign, say Sean Lamass, sends me down the country as if I knew nothing about this city. And as I've told you in Irish, I was living beside this city before he was born. I've been for 56 years now living in the neighborhood of this grand old city. And I've never come to this old city, whether I approached it by land or by sea or by air, that those gleaming lights did not cheer my heart with welcome. We don't come along here in the city and shout about the price of butter and then go down to the farmer and shout about how low the price of milk is. We here in this campaign have tried to get for the people what, as Oscar Traynor has pointed out, is their right. The right to have policies before them so that they may be able to choose which of the policies they believe right in the interest of the country. That is their fundamental right at election times. If they don't get that chance at election times, they'll never get the chance. Because in the interval, having been a representative democracy, the Legislative Assembly, the Valéireann, represents the nation and can take decisions in the nation's name. The only time that the people of the country have an opportunity, really, of deciding upon policy is in election times. And I've been chasing, as other members of our government and as members of Fianna Fáil and candidates have been, we've been chasing our opponents to try to get them to stand their ground somewhere.
Well, Fianna Fáil lost power in 1954 and there was a second inter-party government, again John A. Costello as Taoiseach, and that lasted until 1957, when this was the style of party political broadcast.
Fill her up.
Have you got coupons?
Rationed? Do you mean to stand there and tell me petrol's rationed?
The outgoing Minister for Industry and Commerce, Labour leader, William Norton.
As regards the future, the position is that unless there is some unforeseen and unexpected deterioration in the supply position, it should be possible to maintain the rations at their present level for this month and for March.
It was a remarkable election in several ways.
R.J. Dowling, parliamentary correspondent of Radio Éireann, summarising that 1957 election.
First of all, although nearly a third of the electors did not vote, The result gave us the strongest single-party government ever elected in this state. The Fianna Fáil party captured 78 of the 146 seats, 13 more than they previously had. Remember how it happened? The Dáil was in Christmas recess when Mr. Sean McBride, leader of the Clan Republic, the party, put down a motion of no confidence in the inter-party government. Things could hardly have been more difficult at the time, with the balance of international payments going badly against us, credit and import restrictions tightening, and unemployment going up. Mr. McBride's motion was the last straw. And before the House was due to reconvene in February, the Taoiseach asked the President to dissolve the Dáil. But the change in public opinion had come earlier. In 7 by-elections, the parties of the inter-party government had been beaten 5 times, and their aggregate majority had been whittled down almost to vanishing point. In the event, the Fianna Fáil success would have been greater, were it not for the advent of Sinn Féin, which took 4 seats on an abstentionist policy, 3 of them from outgoing Fianna Fáil candidates. It was remarkable, too, for the atmosphere of caution in which the campaign was conducted. It was an election of no promises. None of the leaders offered the public any pledge in return for support. And it brought the 5th change of government in 36 years. Boiled down, however, there have been only 3 governments in all that time. Cumann na n-Éill, Fianna Fáil, and Inter-Party. And the voting record of the public confirms that, in all the world, this is probably the stablest country, politically, of the lot.
R.J. Dowling. And after those relatively sleepy times came a brief period when so much changed. The Lamass era, 1959 to 1966.
I believe that the real testing time for this country, the test of our will and determination to build up its economy, is now at hand. In a special sense, it is a testing time of our industrial leadership, a test of its capacity and its intention to grasp the future with both hands. If we have the wisdom to plan correctly, if we have the unity that will sink sectional aims in the national purpose, and the enthusiasm for growth and change, which is a sine qua non of progress anywhere, we cannot but succeed.
That was in May. After the general election of October, Mr. Lamass was still Taoiseach.
A familiar voice during that era in the RTE newsroom, John Ross.
The election had brought little actual change in the political situation beyond a reshuffle of seats and the introduction of 35 new faces in the Dáil. The government party, Fianna Fáil, were unable to get in the final spurt which would have brought them a record. They got 70 out of 144 seats. 2 more would have meant an overall majority in 2 successive elections, something that has never been accomplished. The final lineup: Fianna Fáil 70, Fine Gael 47, Labour 16, Clan na Talún 2, Progressive Democrats 2.
And you did hear that correctly. That was an earlier party, different ideology, but with the same name, Progressive Democrats.
Progressive Democrats 2, Clan na Poblachtach 1, and Independent 6. The final picture: a little muzzy around the edges, but no coalition. The independents used their balance of power to put Mr. Lamass's government right back in there, and he was re-elected as Taoiseach by 72 votes to 68. Labour, flushed with some new successes, decided to stand on its own feet, but the policy and management remained the same. Business as usual.
It will be noted here that the tone of political exchanges during those elections varies between a benign mass rally by De Valera in College Green in Dublin in 1954 to an acerbic tone of dismissal from Clan na Poblachtach in 1948. Let's move along now to 1975 and Tom O'Donnell, Minister for the Gaeltacht in the Fine Gael Labour coalition led by Liam Cosgrave. What Tom O'Donnell had to say after a very young candidate called Enda Kenny won a by-election in Mayo West.
And I have no doubt whatsoever that in another 2 years that the West will have completely been won from Fianna Fáil. I wouldn't hesitate at the moment to take on Fianna Fáil in any constituency from Donegal to West Cork.
But the next election provided a different story. It was Jack Lynch's last, and it was a Fianna Fáil landslide.
Our task will be to make it clear to the people the choice that lies before them. Whether they want to continue with the talk, the smoke screens, the propaganda, and the running away from problems which have characterized this coalition government for the last 4 years, or whether they want a real government with real policies, real leadership, real conviction, and real commitment to Ireland and to the Irish people.
No doubt many of you are familiar with
Fine Gael leader and Taoiseach Liam Cosgrave.
An expression in some parts of the country where an outsider is described as a blow-in. Some of these are blow-ins. Now, as far as we're concerned, they can blow out or blow up.
There are some commentators who think that that remark was a costly mistake in the following election. This is how Liam Cosgrave conceded defeat in 1977.
While the results of all the counts are not yet available, the indications are that when the new Dáil meets on the 5th of July next, there will be a change of government. I shall facilitate the smooth transfer of administration to my successor in accordance with the decision of the people.
A combination of arrogance and complacency and blaming the rest of the world on our ills. I think people like the government to face up to their own problems rather than to blame everybody else.
By the time the next election came along in 1981, Garrett Fitzgerald was Fine Gael leader and Charles Haughey was Taoiseach and Fianna Fáil leader.
The headlines: the Taoiseach has called a general election. Polling day is to be June the 11th. The President has dissolved the Dáil at Mr. Haughey's request.
Because of the grave and tragic situation which has been developing in Northern Ireland, over recent weeks particularly.
This is Charles Haughey's reference to the hunger strikes. And indeed, there were two H-Block candidates who both stood and were abstentionist candidates. They were in jail anyway, and both won seats at the expense of Fianna Fáil.
It is now essential also that the government should have a clear and definite mandate from the people to pursue their efforts to achieve a political solution to this problem, which will bring the present terrible cycle of violence and death to an end.
In that election, Garrett Fitzgerald became Taoiseach, but this, his first Fine Gael Labour coalition, lasted a matter of months when its fragile majority came under pressure, when the budget included VAT on clothing and shoes, and that included children's shoes.
Well, I was always conscious of the fact that my vote might in fact bring the government down.
Limerick TD Jim Kemmy, on whose support that government was dependent.
I understand you talked with the Taoiseach earlier this evening. Can you give us some idea of what that discussion was all about?
On two occasions, just once at 6:30, when I went to his office and his request, I felt that I couldn't in conscience support the budget. And also had a brief word with the Taoiseach. About 1 minute, a half minute before the vote was cast. At that stage, it dawned on him, and certainly dawned on him, but it was too late then. I told him that I had been cast, my mind was made up, and there was no going back. And I really felt sorry for him as well at that point, because I could see sadness in his eyes as well. I myself felt very sorry.
At the moment of that defeat in the Dáil, I felt a sense of exhilaration that at last we had a chance of going to the country on a real issue, an issue of reality, an issue that would call forth the sense of maturity that Irish people have in a crisis of this kind. And I was confident from that moment onwards that the people would rise to it, and they have. And you will see that on Thursday next, or rather you'll see it on Friday when the results begin to come in.
And when the results came in, it was a hung Dáil, no clear result. One newcomer, independent TD Tony Gregory for Dublin Central, said he would support Haughey or Fitzgerald depending on what they promised to his constituency.
It became clear to both myself and the people who were attending the meetings with me that Mr. Haughey was responding more positively by far than Dr. Fitzgerald.
So after the February 1982 election, Charles Haughey became Taoiseach. The humorists were happy.
And now back to the main story, the National Weather Agreement. With me is on Taoiseach Charles J. Haughey. Now, workers will say that we have had hard winters before, and the government promised to do something about it, and here we are again, snow.
Well, of course, that's debatable. I would not entirely agree that there has been snow.
I'm sorry, but I must put it to you that there has been snow. Workers have been out in the cold. They have found conditions hard for the past few years. Snow has been the experience on the ground.
Well, I was not aware that there was snow. or that there had been a negative reaction.
Now, you see, you promised a little ray of sunshine soon, and on that basis, the workers said they would not push for bigger umbrellas. And yet again, this week, more snow, more cold.
Well, and I would not call it snow as such. There has been a slight variation in temperature.
The meteorologists are calling it snow.
Well, of course, meteorology is a dismal science.
The workers would say that the government has fiddled with the barometers, kept the employers warm, while they have been out in the cold. Now, you know nothing about their conditions.
I must correct you on that. Many of my people, in fact, were alpine farmers. I myself spent my school holidays within a yodel of the Eiger. Zepp Hawhey was a toboggan champion, and I myself learned to ski jump at Innsbruck when a local wag pushed me. I can recall Franz Klammer's father once dropping into our chalet during a giant slalom when he missed one of the gates and hit our front door at over 100 kilometres per hour, and in fact ran over Heidi Hawhey, my aunt, before exiting through the rear wall, which left a great impression on me, and of course a perfect impression of him in the wall. The Von Trapps were very personal friends of mine, and I used to often wonder, how do you solve a problem like Maria? How, in a sense, do you catch a wave and pin it down? So I've bobsleighed with the best of them. I knew the crest to run personally, and of course it's not properly appreciated that Hansi Hawhey was a lonely goat-haired yodel-ay-tee. I myself have often been on the pist, like my uncle Fritzi Hawhey, who was a great sportsman, played inter-canton curdling in Switzerland. And
this particular tilt at Charles Hawhey's capacity to tell his story, his life story, was a favourite with listeners to Scrap Saturday and to Dermot Morgan.
Of course, it's not widely known, perhaps, that some of my ancestors actually came from Japan.
Well, here we go.
My great-great-grandfather was one of the seven samurai, while one distant cousin was a Shinto priest in an enclosed order. I myself used to spend my summers there as a boy. After the war, I would go back to visit Hiroshima, which would remind me a lot of George in Dublin after my property pals in Taka had developed it. And often I would look out at the lotus blossom and go for a stroll up Mount Fuji with some of the local geishas and a six-pack of sake. My first motorbike was a Honda, after all, and Uncle Yakasaki Hawhey was a thriving cherry farmer till he flew his Zero into the superstructure of a US aircraft carrier. And at night, we would sit around a fire shouting Banzai with Ayasoki Hawhey. He was on my mother's side, and we would tear into the rice wine, and he would practice a bit of sumo on me, which, of course, was a very rewarding experience. He used to give me a few yen to let him. He died a bachelor too, of course, you know, and I miss the cherry blossom falling lightly on my Toyota and the soft music of the Sony. Nippon, my Nippon. This is Kaholo Yoki for 88 FM.
And we'll have more from the RTE Sound Archives on elections and politics next Sunday morning.
I fought two different kinds of general elections.
Would the real Desmond O'Malley really stand up? Well, here he is.
When you're a candidate just locally, you concentrate on your own constituency. And physically it's fairly wearing, but at least you're concentrated on the one area. I was leader of a party for three general elections, I think. And that's a very different thing because you're trying to cover a large part of the country.
This is from the archives of The Sunday Show, taken from a broadcast during the last, the 2002 general election. Desmond O'Malley talking to Miles Duncan.
What I found was the invention of the helicopter was a great help because it meant that you could cover four or five constituencies in a day, or not cover them, but at least visit them. And you arrived back at the end of the day and you weren't totally exhausted. If you're fighting a particular constituency, you get very bound up with what's going on there, and you actually lose track to a fair extent of what's going on elsewhere. You hardly have time to read the papers, and in a way you're hardly interested. You're concentrating very much on your own campaign.
But also you'd go back to the days before television and before the demands of television and before this old market research thing that we were talking about took hold in politics. And the day when people actually made speeches off the backs of lorries and that kind of thing.
Oh yes, I remember that. certainly for the first 10 or 15 years, I think, that I was campaigning, you did make speeches off the backs of lorries. Television was there, but it didn't play anything like the part that it now does. And I remember when I got elected in 1968, all deputies were invited at that time to go on a television course if they wanted to. And we were all sent out to the famous Buddy Carr, and we were divided into threes. And I was put with the late Pow Donnell, who was a Fine Gael deputy from Donegal, and Tom Kine, who was a Labour man from Waterford. And the three of us spent a day at it, and then we had to watch ourselves on a video. That was very new at that time, at the end. And Carr made comments on it. And I remember Pow Donnell turned to Tom Kine, and he said, "Tom, I don't know whether this television thing will take off or not, but if it does, O'Malley would be good at it. I think you and I can forget about it."
Desmond O'Malley.
But from December 1979, when Charles Haughey replaced Jack Lynch as leader of Fianna Fáil, there was a target for the satirists.
It's not malice, it's mischief.
Another noted practitioner, the late Dermot Morgan.
"It feels malicious sometimes, especially when you're really enjoying it. But I think it's more mischief. So, I mean, I don't, when I start to take off a politician, I'm probably working from, let's say, the language they use and from the way they talk. They tend to be a natural object. You tend to find your targets in the media. Isn't it true you're guilty of mass murder? We found bodies in the back garden. There are bodies in your kitchen. There are skeletons in your cupboard. We have documented." "No, I wouldn't accept that at all. I've always acted in the interests of my constituents." And this is this kind of general blandness. It's when you see an inflated ego, I think that's what's so much fun, is to start deflating a large ego. And naturally, I mean, the name of the game for a statesman or a politician is that they must have a sense of authority, they must have power.
"What I miss most about power is the reins I held and the greenness of the people and the free stationery with Taoiseach's office and a harp on it." "And the long evening meetings of the parliamentary party, and friends coming in to vote against me, and the free stationery with Taoiseach's office and a harp on it. And Sheila de Valera, the way she might look at you. My grandfather was a very great man. And the free stationery with Taoiseach's office and a harp on it. The money is good, and the Mercedes are free. You could fry an egghead if I still had Martin O'Donoghue. And you could certainly sink Desi O'Malley or George Colley with my free stationery with Taoiseach's office and a harp on it. If I only had my free stationery with Taoiseach's office and a harp on it."
By the time the next election came along in 1981, Garrett Fitzgerald was Fine Gael leader and Charles Haughey was Taoiseach and Fianna Fáil leader.
The headlines: the Taoiseach has called a general election. Polling day is to be June the 11th. The President has dissolved the Dáil at Mr. Haughey's request.
"Because of the grave and tragic situation which has been developing in Northern Ireland, over recent weeks particularly, it is now essential also that the government should have a clear and definite mandate from the people to pursue their efforts to achieve a political solution to this problem, which will bring the present terrible cycle of violence and death to an end. I'm confident that the people will give Fianna Fáil the support we're seeking to continue with our comprehensive programme of national development without interruption in the years immediately ahead. I'm gonna play my trump card. And don't you know it's gonna go hard with you? I'm
democratic right to come and talk to the people of Ireland, and the people of Ireland have that same democratic right to come out and meet us and talk to us, and anybody that wants to interfere with that better get out of this country and go to some fascist country where they belong.
From southern lands to western shores, the ancient cry of freedom roars. From northern hills to Leinster's doors, we'll rise and follow Charlie. Charlie's song we'll sing as one.
Do you accept that this election is to an extent, perhaps to a substantial extent, about the people's verdict on you, the Irish people's verdict on you?
Very much so, yes, I do. And that's what I am campaigning about mainly. I'm going directly to the people on this occasion, meeting as many of them as I can, personally, in the towns and villages, at the crossroads, in the streets, asking them for a mandate, for their direct mandate, to enable me in the next 5 years to go ahead and make a major impact on the life of this nation of ours.
Use your vote the whole way down. And that whenever there's a couple of three or four places there are at the bottom, reserve them for the feet of all candidates and put them in the order of your choice. Because some may be worse than others. But vote the whole way down. Vote the Fine Gael vote the Fine Gael ticket 1, 2, 3 solidly. Don't let a vote drift away till you've voted for the three Fine Gael candidates.
Well, it was Garrett Fitzgerald who became Taoiseach after that 1981 summer election. But judge for yourself who won the song contest.
Fine Gael, Fine Gael, a bright new future we hail, a bright new future we hail, led by Garrett, the man you know. You won't be taking a chance, you won't be taking a chance. The world is changing so fast, so fast, so fast. No time to look to the past, no time to look to the past. So it's forward.
Because I have over 20 years in the work I've been doing in different areas of public life, outside politics as well as inside politics, in a sense been preparing for this, and I'd like to put that preparation to good use for the country's sake, if the country gives me their confidence, as I hope they will.
And that proved to be the outcome. Garrett Fitzgerald became Taoiseach for the first time after that election. But initially, it was a very complicated election result to read as it came in, and this is reflected in this recording from RTE's television coverage. Remember that along with the usual excitement of an election results programme, new faces in and big names losing out, all that reality TV as it were, there can also be the tentative first sounding out of possible coalitions taking place on the airwaves on these occasions. And here is an example from that first of four Haughey versus Fitzgerald elections. Some points you need to know. The Labour leader, Frank Klusky, lost his seat in this election. His probable successor, Michael O'Leary, was more sympathetic to a coalition with Fine Gael, and he was in the television studio. I was anchoring the radio coverage, and Charlie Haughey was shy about coming near the RTE radio or television studios. But he did want to put his spin in for just some listeners. His parliamentary party, his new parliamentary party, which was deeply divided and had his future leadership in their hands, a point he well knew. Then he became available to read out a statement on the telephone and coming through live to the radio coverage. He said he did not want supplementary questions, but no strict veto had been conveyed to me. So my aim was to get him to answer as many questions as possible, and if a point came when he wouldn't take any more, he could state that. I wasn't going to be the censor. Whether a censor intervened eventually will be for you to decide. This comes from the television sound. They used our scoop. Brian Farrell in the chair, and importantly, the probable next Labour leader, Michael O'Leary. in studio also.
One short last question, I think, from Basil Chubb.
Michael, the argument you were
Can
just using...
Can I interrupt you, Basil? I'm sorry, because I understand that there's a statement coming from the Taoiseach. Is it coming straight through now, Liam? Yeah.
And the television coverage here was taking our scoop, taking the sound from Charles Haughey on the telephone to the radio coverage.
I would like, as leader of Fianna Fáil, to convey my gratitude to all our election workers and all those who supported and voted for us. That we did not secure an overall majority was not due to any lack of effort or commitment. The fact that in face of all the difficulties and the combined opposition of all the other parties and groups, we emerged in such a dominant position is a tribute to our great organization and to all its members. Our resolve now must be to continue our work for Ireland as the party to which the largest majority of our people give their trust and support.
Right, Mr. Haughey, you don't want to accept, I think, an interview at this stage, but you are prepared, I think, to answer some supplementary questions. Is that right?
I'm not sure. Are we on the air?
We are on the air, yes.
I didn't understand that.
I'm sorry.
We were both sorry. He was sorry that he hadn't been simply thanked for his statement, which was principally intended for his very disappointed party, especially parliamentary party. He didn't want them to think of him as having lost the election. My sorry was a courtesy, in case there had been any misunderstanding about his contribution to the programme. But my intention was, of course, to get a scoop by moving as quickly as possible into interview mode and teasing out Haughey's immediate intentions. He didn't really want to be interviewed. He never liked impromptu interviews anyway. What happened next?
I know that it's a difficult moment for you, and you obviously
Somebody seems to be coming in and out and cutting us off.
Right. Well, can I ask you what your intentions are now? You obviously will be proposed for Taoiseach when the Dáil resumes, but will you be talking in the meantime to independents to seek their support?
No, but I'd be available if anybody wishes to talk to me.
And would you go into power, for instance, with Mr. Blaney's support?
Well, the position is that I will be proposed for Taoiseach, and then it will be up to anybody in the Dáil who wishes to support that nomination to do so.
But Mr. Lynch, going into the last election, said that he wouldn't accept support from Mr. Blaney. He wouldn't be comfortable going into power with Mr. Blaney's support. Would that be your view?
Well, what I've said, my position is, as I've said, that I will certainly be proposed as Taoiseach. We are with the intention of forming a government, and if any member any side of the Dáil wishes to support us, well, we certainly will accept that support. I mean, we won't turn any support away.
Do you expect then to be Taoiseach in the 22nd Dáil?
That's our intention.
Do you think it will last its full term?
Well, that's another question.
There are three factors, I think, in your favour on this occasion. One is that you are coming from a very high position of the 77 poll, so Fianna Fáil could really only go down.
I'm very sorry, the line is very bad.
I'm just saying that there are three factors, perhaps, in your favour. It's a very creditable performance, perhaps, for Fianna Fáil, more than it has been given credit for. One of them being that the constituency scarcely helped you, that inflation tends to run against existing governments, and thirdly, that you were, after all, coming from a very high in 77. Therefore, you could really only perhaps come down. Would you accept that?
Well, I would, in general, I'd accept most of what you're saying. Particularly, I would say that the large number of five-seat constituencies certainly didn't help us. And, of course, there's always a difficulty for a government in office because you have to carry the burden of all the economic and social problems.
What about the leadership of the party? Will that be questioned now, do you think?
Well, no, I have no indication whatsoever of anything like that.
You haven't looked around the faces, the new Fianna Fáil faces winning, and wonder whether they're your supporters or not?
No, that doesn't arise. They're all good Fianna Fáil people. A solid organisation. We fought this election as a very good united team and we don't have that sort of problem.
The regional pattern, of course, is very important, and you have held your ground very significantly in the west of the country but not doing so well in Munster and Leinster. What about the H-block issue specifically, the fact that two have been elected? What are the implications of that, do you believe?
You can put your own interpretation on it. As Brian Lennon was saying the other night, there's certainly a great deal of emotion involved. People feel deeply about the tragic deaths. I have no doubt it's a reflection of that to a large extent.
Harold Wilson once said that a week was a long time in politics. We now have 2 weeks ahead of us. That's going to be a long time, isn't it?
Oh.
Charles Hawkey. We had a problem with the telephone on that, but we...
And that was our good friend and colleague, John Bowman, on the wireless there, up all night. I heard him as I was going home myself at 4:45 in great form. And, of course, we'd have much better performance if the Taoiseach felt free to come in. The studio, of course, readily available to him today, as it was yesterday, to tell us what his current views are. Michael O'Leary in the College of Technology in Bolton Street. What do you think, listening to that, what do you think Mr. Hawkey is likely to do?
Well, I think the wooing of the independence has commenced.
Well, you don't really object to wooing. After all, loving is a great Christian charity and a virtue.
Well, put it any way you like, but certainly I would imagine that whatever may have been the deficiencies of that line in which the Taoiseach made that communication, whether Albert Reynolds was behind it or not, I would say that other lines will be very clear this afternoon to the people who have been elected as independents. And I don't think the Taoiseach will brook any interruptions in those important conversations. And perhaps at this very moment, it is more important for the Taoiseach to make communication with those independents than to use the facilities of your studio at this moment, the electorate. After all, their importance has receded at this point, and the importance of the independents has become crucial to the survival of this government.
And the rest, as they say, is history. Charles Hawkey failed to remain Taoiseach. Garrett Fitzgerald formed his first government with Michael O'Leary as Thornister. This morning's programme was based on original programmes by Frank Hall, Eamon Morrissey, Frank Kelly, Charles Kelly, Dermot Morgan, John A. Murphy, Shane Kenny, Pat McInerney, Charlie Bird, Edmund Hall, Betty Purcell, Noel O'Reilly, Bernadette O'Sullivan, Tom Manning, Brian Farrell and Liam Miller. More from the political and election archives at the same time on Sunday morning next. Thank you for listening this morning and good morning.
This morning from the archives, we're concentrating first on what has happened in the aftermath of indecisive election outcomes. What's in the archives on the subject of government formation? First, 1948.
Political issues for the last quarter of a century have been judged on the basis of personalities and past affiliations rather than upon their merits.
This is Sean McBride, founder and leader of Clonmel Publica in the 1948 general election.
The younger people, the people of under 40, the people with no national record, came to feel that public affairs did not concern them.
Sean McBride did not underestimate the challenge as he saw it. Clonmel Publica's role was nothing less than to save the country.
The paramount problem is the survival of our nation. Our population is now less than 3 million. This year, it is lower than it has ever been before in the course of our whole history. Our principal export consists of the blood and flesh of our young people. Inversely, we import paper money and are selling our country piecemeal to alien interests. If the present trend is allowed to continue, in another quarter of a century, this nation will have ceased to exist.
Now, I play that to bring us back to 1948, after which election there was the most extraordinary Wheeler dealing. Fianna Fáil and Eamon de Valera in particular had every reason to believe that they had again retained power in the 1948 election. It was one of Fine Gael's worst results ever. They had dipped below 20%. But Fine Gael were to go into government, led not by General Dick Mulcahy, their then leader, but by a compromise candidate for Taoiseach, John A. Costello. It was sometimes talked of as a bar library plot, Costello and McBride, plus two branches of the Labour Party, Clonmel Thaloon and sundry independents. Ideologically and temperamentally, a motley crew, but united on one point only. Get Dev out.
The programme of Fianna Fáil has now been definitely adopted as the national policy of the Irish people.
That was Eamon de Valera 16 years before in the 1932 election, and the incoming intra-party government in 1948 argued that Fianna Fáil had had their chance. There was, as I've said, much wheeler dealing between the outcome of the election and the emergence of the new government. But alas, there is no trace at all of this in RTE sound archives. This because such political interviewing did not take place in those years. Contrast that with the rich pickings for archivists and historians in more recent years.
Whatever happens tomorrow, Charles Hawkey is
preparing the ground for his return to the office of Taoiseach.
This is the February 1982 election. David Davenport.
Yesterday, he met the independent TD, Tony Gregory, to discuss how he could win his support in the vital vote for Taoiseach on March the 9th. Tony Gregory is well known for his work in the inner city, and local authority housing and unemployment are sure to be part of his proposals at the bargaining table. Earlier today, Fintan Drury spoke to Tony Gregory by phone and asked him how last night's meeting with Mr. Haughey had gone.
Well, Mr. Haughey met us and discussed our proposals for about an hour and a half. I suppose it was a friendly discussion. It was interesting from both sides, but there were certainly no agreements reached. Mr. Haughey agreed to come back to us when he had considered our proposals, and we would have a further discussion at that stage.
What proposals did you put to Mr. Haughey?
Well, we're not in a position to go into the specifics of the proposals at the moment for the simple reason we've yet to meet the other people in the Dáil who hope also the former government, and to put the same proposals to them and to hear what their response is to them, and to make a decision based on that.
Well, is there a price for Tony Gregory's loyalty in this 23rd Dáil?
No, there's certainly no price for my loyalty as such. What is happening is people and groupings within the Dáil wish to form a government, and they're asking for my support and a vote for Taoiseach. And to do that, I need to know what the policies of that Taoiseach would be in relation to the vital issues that affect the people whom I represent and affect this country as a whole.
There were more meetings, again covered on RTE Radio.
Well, I'm certainly very encouraged by what both Dr. Fitzgerald and Mr. Haughey had to say with us. I think they were very responsive to us. We don't expect either government, whatever government will come in, certainly to meet our views in full as to the type of society we would like to have in this country. But we feel that they intend to go as far as they can to implement certain of the proposals that we, as many of the proposals we have put to them as they feel they can.
On balance now, can you make an assessment of how you're going to vote on Tuesday?
No, I've just met Dr. Fitzgerald yesterday for the first time. He's to come back to us at the weekend, and there may be a further meeting after that. We've met Mr. Haughey on two occasions, and we're meeting him again at the weekend.
Tony Gregory is still keeping his powder dry in public.
Getting into power was important to Charles Haughey. His very continuing leadership of the party itself was at stake.
I, for this reason,
Desmond O'Malley,
that constantly over the past year or more I've been asked questions about whether or not I would be interested in the leadership of Fianna Fáil, and I replied to those questions in recent months truthfully by saying that when the next occasion arose that I proposed to be a candidate, that I had withdrawn or hadn't gone forward on the last occasion, although there was a fair bit of pressure on me in December 1979 to go forward, and that I certainly would go forward on the next occasion.
Ray McSharry commented.
The dissatisfaction and annoyance within the party and the organisation and those who supported us is that all they want to see is a Fianna Fáil government on the 9th of March. That's what their concern is. And their concern is expressed in many ways to many deputies and to the headquarters of Fianna Fáil. And anybody who will make any move to in any way jeopardize that situation, they will never be forgiven by Fianna Fáil party.
In the event Charles Haughey won power, with the support of independents, including Tony Gregory, who had driven a hard bargain, an historically hard bargain, again chronicled in RTE's sound archives.
Having met with both contenders for the position of Taoiseach, and having put to them the main issues on which I was elected, and which I felt I had a responsibility to establish what the any particular incoming government was prepared to do on those issues, it became clear to both myself and the people who were attending the meetings with me that Mr. Haughey was responding more positively by far than Dr. Fitzgerald, and that certainly in the major issues of the Dublin Corporation's housing programme and the unemployment situation, that Mr. Haughey was prepared to give very specific commitments, to give a timescale on those commitments, and to say that he would honour them. Dr. Fitzgerald was in my view, quite pessimistic in his approach and felt that the economy couldn't sustain the injection of resources that we felt was necessary.
Time for an aside here. That Fianna Fáil government was sometimes called by its opponents the Gubu government. It only lasted a number of months. There was to be another election that November of 1982. But looking back at the 1980s, Dermot Morgan gave this verdict.
Now, of course, the 1980s for you must have been the period of Gubu.
Well, of course, it was Gubu in many respects, gratifying, unparalleled, brilliant and...
Una duce, una voce?
And unsurpassed. You stop that tape, Sonny. Who are you? How dare you throw that one at me? I'm not Seamus Brennan. I won't wear this. I'm referring this to another authority. Thank God we have an ombudsman.
There was then another election in November 1982, the third in 18 months. This time a decisive result for Garret Fitzgerald as Taoiseach and for a Fine Gael Labour coalition. That lasted 5 years. Charles Haughey came back in 1987 to form a minority Fianna Fáil government. He was tempted 2 years later to call a snap election to attempt for the fifth time to win an overall majority. Again, it eluded him. And what followed was heresy.
My view on coalition is the same as it was a week to 10 days ago and as it was yesterday.
A relative newcomer to the Dáil, the then Meath backbencher Noel Dempsey.
Given the opportunity this morning, it would be the same parliamentary party meeting this morning.
The heresy was that Fianna Fáil would break what had always been proclaimed as one of its core values, no coalition. But Fianna Fáil was now 6 votes short of power, and it was the dreaded PDs, whose very name Charlie Haughey managed never to even mention. They had 6 seats.
Well, there's still no agreement, I'm afraid.
Mary Harney, ex-Fianna Fáil, a founder of the PDs, though not yet leader, and an architect of that compromise.
What is the sticking point?
I'm not in a position to say that.
What were the details of the conversations between the Taoiseach and your leader this morning?
I wouldn't be aware of that.
When is the next meeting
present.
Scheduled?
I'm not sure, but there's one scheduled for later this morning.
Aren't the PDs pushing things a little far at this stage? Aren't you playing a very hard ball game? Are you not afraid it's going to come unstuck?
I don't think we are. All we're looking for is a fair contribution to the next government. We want to be there in a meaningful way so that we can have some of our policies implemented.
But given the proportion of seats you have in government, isn't it fair to suggest that you get one seat and leave it at that? Isn't it pushing things to suggest that you get more?
I don't think it is, no. I think given the circumstances that we're in and given the fact that we've been waiting 4 weeks now to elect a government, I think it's fair and reasonable that the Progressive Democrats should have a meaningful input into the next government. And that obviously requires having more than one person at the cabinet table.
Are you content to push things to the brink at this late hour, the last hour, and maybe bring the country towards another general election?
We wouldn't wish to do that. It's all now in Mr. Haughey's hands. I understand he's been given the freedom by his party to negotiate, and I think we should leave it to that.
Charles Haughey had played a blinder. He well knew that the last challenge an incoming parliamentary party was an immediate fresh election. Some of that parliamentary party would be new TDs. They may even have surprised their constituency colleagues by winning seats. Not new extra Fianna Fáil seats, but a seat at the expense of a running mate, now a former TD. They didn't want a fresh election. But that position is not true of these three Fianna Fáil voices from the archives, facing up to the new situation, Gerard Brady, Mary Coughlan, and John Wilson.
Well, I'm always optimistic anyway. And I'd say it's now or never.
Confident that everything will work out today. Hopefully.
Good morning, Deputy Brady. How do you feel going into the parliamentary party meeting this morning?
Fine, thank you very much.
Do you think that the PDs are going to get one or more cabinet posts?
Oh, that's a matter for the leaders of the parties to decide. It wouldn't be a situation for me to comment on at all.
But the last to be convinced was Meath backbencher Noel Dempsey. Marion Richardson spoke to him just hours before the new government was formed.
So what do you think the outcome will be? Do you think there are more like you?
Well, going on yesterday's meeting, I would have to say that of all the people that spoke expressed reservations about coalition, but very few of them expressed outright opposition. I would say that there is quite a substantial majority in the parliamentary party in favour of doing a deal. I'm not sure until we get the details how many will be actually in favour of the actual deal that's concluded.
But you are adamant that you will vote against coalition?
I'm against the principle and I feel in conscience that I have to vote against it.
Some of the history of how governments are formed in the aftermath of an election taken from RTE's sound archives. Those recordings from 1989, the first occasion on which Fianna Fáil formed a coalition government. and whenever in power since, which is most of the time, it's always been a coalition government.
If we're not going to use them this time, when will we use them?
Another controversy of relevance at this time is also in the archives, the whole debate about electronic voting.
How much is it costing us to store them?
The great electronic voting machine, used in three constituencies on a pilot basis in 2002, in Meath, in Dublin West, and in Dublin North.
I tell you for his father, and I tell you for Brian himself, and this is my third count here in Dublin West. The atmosphere is not it because people are hanging around here. Nobody knows who's going to win, who's going to lose. Here, it's all over a matter of a second, you know?
Tom Kitt has operated as a tallyman in the last three general elections, and clearly he was not impressed by what he witnessed at City West in Dublin early this morning, where the results of Dublin North and Dublin West were being electronically counted.
The mixing and numbering has been completed, so the next step now, we have secured the database, and the next step now is...
The results for Dublin West were due to be announced by midnight, but it was 2 o'clock in the morning before there was any development.
We now have printouts, so could I have all the candidates down to the left-hand side here, and we give them the printouts.
Deputy Returning Officer Orla Fitzpatrick there telling candidates in Dublin West that they would first receive a written breakdown of the last count in their constituency, showing the winners and the losers, before there was a public declaration. But almost immediately there was confusion. A note appeared on the large screens, showing some of the results. And then there was further confusion. On reading the breakdown, the Socialist Party's Joe Higgins put his fist in the air to signal to his supporters that he had topped the poll. But within minutes, Fianna Fáil's Brian Lenehan was making similar claims. And the declaration a few minutes later didn't seem to clarify the matter.
I hereby declare the following persons elected as members of Dáil Éireann for the constituency west of Dublin West. Brian Lenehan, Fianna Fáil, Joe Higgins, Socialist Party, and Joan Burton.
Joe Higgins and Brian Lenehan were clearly confused.
Have you got a first count that you can show me there?
We just have the last.
We only have the last count because of this computer count, but it would appear I topped the poll and was the first person elected in Dublin West and in Ireland in this election.
Unfortunately, we still haven't got the earlier counts, only the last count, so I'm at a loss.
And Joe Higgins was clearly angry.
If the last 2 hours is anything to go by, bring back the tally people. We weren't subjected to the type of shambles that we have here. I went to the trouble of writing to the Minister for the Environment suggesting how the count should be conducted when I heard that this was a method. Unfortunately, I didn't get a reply, but it's quite clear that the method of presentation of the results is an absolute shambles, a disgrace and an insult actually to those who went out and fought the elections.
A half an hour later, there was more controversy when the results of Dublin North were being declared. This time, the candidates stood behind Returning Officer John Fitzpatrick, who gave them a written breakdown of the last count before he made the declaration.
And those elected were as follows. Trevor Sargent. Sean Ryan.
But Nora Owen, who lost her seat, was clearly shocked by the announcement and was directed into a side room to recover.
It's like a sudden death, and it is very, very painful. And all the candidates, all of us, even those elected, quite frankly, are suffering a lot, and it was a very painful and frustrating process, and really there has to be another way of handling this. I don't believe it was handled tonight in a way that had any dignity or humanity in it.
Though victorious, Fianna Fáil candidate Jim Glennon was visibly angry at what had happened.
We were trying to peer over the returning officer's shoulder, and in fact I got it wrong, because I thought in trying to decipher what he had written down in his own handwriting on the page that I saw, I felt there was no change, and I didn't think I had been elected. I thought I saw Nora Owen's name on the page. But we were peering over his shoulder, trying to find out who had been elected. And certainly somebody, particularly of Nora Owen's distinguished service, deserves better than that.
Fianna Fáil's GB Wright was also unhappy.
I think the whole system is wrong and has to be re-looked at. And I certainly, on my return to the Dáil, I'll be asking whatever future ministers involved that there is no way that the charade, as I see it here tonight, should be repeated.
But Returning Officer John Fitzpatrick said he had simply followed the guidelines he was given.
My way of doing it would have been to do the count, first count, second count, third count, on the screen, let them look at it right through. It's a bit rough just hitting them with it at that, but that's the way we were told to do it, and that's the way the programme did it. I didn't have any option.
Now, you heard what was said there.
I did.
Shambles, charade. But actually, they're talking about method of presentation.
Well, that's very much what they're talking about. Mm. I'd have to say that I'm surprised at the presentation and the way it was done. If I could, for just a moment, David, what happened in Meath was the process was run through the various stages as would have happened in the other two Dublin constituencies. The candidates were asked to assemble or brought to the front, asked to assemble in a room to the side. The returning officer then came into the room, met with the candidates and gave us verbally what the result was to prepare us for that and to allow us to prepare for that. And once that process was finished, we were moved out immediately to the count area, lined up beside the presiding or the returning officer, who made the announcement. And I think that gave candidates a fair enough chance to prepare themselves for what was going to happen. And as you know, we had one change in County Meath in relation to personnel. One Fine Gael candidate replaced another, and I think that was a proper way to do it, and I think should have been followed elsewhere. I mean, to my mind, there was no rigid guidelines in relation to this.
Should there have been?
Well, when you see the difference that in the way candidates were treated, yes, I suppose.
They were treated cruelly, to use Trevor Sargent's word. Sure, there's still, well, perhaps you won't be back as minister responsible, I don't know, but whoever, can it kind of cruelty?
I can tell you one thing. From 1989, I sat through 13 counts,
yes,
thinking all of the time that I was going to lose my seat.
And is that and even more cruel?
I'll tell you, that's an awful lot more cruel, yes, than...
Then there's been a wider debate about electronic voting, whether it is a better system. First, the machines used in 2002 were not sufficiently tamper-proof. That has been agreed.
A text, to me, it says, Luddites 1, Fianna Fáil 0.
From the Today with Pat Kenny programme last year.
Which brings me to the man sitting opposite me now. He fought the law, and the law did not win, it seems. He won. And this man is one of the key individuals who provoked the government into establishing the commission. His name is Joe McCarthy. He's an independent computers consultant, and he's with me in the studio. Do I detect an air of smug satisfaction from you, Joe, this morning?
Good morning, Pat. I had to write out 100 lines last night. I must not gloat.
But you are.
But no, I'm very pleased that the Commission has, in fact, endorsed every one of the conclusions I came to in my report last December. The title of my report was An Incomplete System, An Unproven System. And that's exactly what the Commission found.
Joe McCarthy acknowledged the system had some merits.
It's singularly successful at helping people who make mistakes from preventing those mistakes. About 1% of all voters make mistaken marks like 3 ones or 2 ones against candidates' names, and that's a spoiled vote, and the system helps prevent that.
Humans interacting with computers. This is a major field of study.
There's a whole science to dealing with how to design machines that are intuitive for people to use, and this machine is not intuitive. Quite a lot of people were pressing the digital display instead of the pink button.
Yes.
I couldn't tell the difference between one and the other. So there are simple things that cause confusion.
And the button is not a real button, it's a pressure-sensitive pad.
Yes.
And I must say, when I saw it first, that confused me. But again, I mean...
It doesn't particularly go click, and it doesn't stay clicked.
No, it doesn't go chip or anything. It doesn't even make sound. When
There's a serious amount of design on ordinary keyboards to give a tactile feedback to your finger as you go click, click.
Yeah. All right, but... That kind of mechanical design, although we're stuck with these machines, it seems we bought them, that kind of mechanical design, in theory, could be overcome.
I'm not sure that it can, Pat.
No, but I mean, not necessarily on this machine, but you could design a machine that would do everything that this machine does, but do it better.
I would still hold my opinion on that. Much of the research in the States now is showing that any of the electronic voting systems that they have invented are poor. They've just withdrawn them in California. Four of the counties in California, the secretary...
What do you make of the Indians going big time?
They have a very simple system and a very straightforward system. I've looked at it. They just vote straight past the post and they use a picture. You put your finger on the picture and that's it, once. That system is quite intuitive
and
quite easy to use.
You've got one vote?
You just vote for the party. You don't even vote for a person.
All right, so it's very simple.
It's extremely simple.
It's a very simple count as well.
Yeah, and you print out the count off the machine at the end of the day.
Take us through then what the Commission said, which agrees with so much of what you were saying.
Well, the testing, it fell down in spades on testing. There was no end-to-end test. There was no independent end-to-end test whatsoever. The manner in which the testing was conducted was poor. Some of the components were not tested at all, and particularly where the components interface with one another. You mentioned earlier that there could have been up to four ballots on the one poll, and the individual votes have to be brought back to a collection centre, and the collection process wasn't tested, and then they have to be disaggregated so that you get the votes for the town council separate from the votes for the county council, separate from the votes for the European Parliament, separate from the votes for the referendum.
Would you be happy if there had been different modules for each of those polls?
No, I would not.
You know, different collection modules.
No, the collection modules themselves are fraught with problems. And they're at the heart of the technology, the little blue ballot modules, so-called. They cost a fortune, by the way, and all that's in them is a memory chip. The entire design of this system needs to be examined from the ground up, and reverse engineering your way back into it to try to fix it is the wrong approach, I'm afraid. It needs to be scrapped.
It needs to be scrapped. So all those millions.
53 million euros spent to date, I have all the invoices, has been spent to date on it. And I'm afraid it's a complete waste.
One of the most disturbing things was perhaps what they said about counting.
Yes. Counting errors are endemic in this system and have been since Mr. Jan Janssen started to program it in January of 2002.
He's been at it for more than 2 years.
He issues a new release every 13 working days. And the conclusion was that they still don't have the current version of software that was needed for June. It is still not working. It won't ever work. It's being designed by a single individual.
Now, the minister's kind of said, that's it. On the basis of the Commission findings, we're going to call a halt.
Yes.
But is there any case for using the election in June as a test?
No. The previous test that was run was flawed.
Does that mean that everyone who is elected or not elected has a case?
They have an absolutely strong moral case. They have no legal case, unfortunately, because there's a statute bar for elections after 6 months. You need certainty in elections no more than the President Bush case. You have to have a president. You can't have two half-presidents. It's the same with any allocation of power. What we're dealing with here is the right of the people of Ireland to designate the rulers, the exercise of power. So power must be exercised deliberately and carefully. Even if it's slightly mistakenly, you still have to decide.
And the issue came up in the last hours of the 29th Dáil. But this was as much about the opposition scoring points by criticising the voting machines, their cost, their storage costs, as it was about the principle of electronic voting.
I saw Minister Dempsey emerging sheepishly at a breakfast that he bought for the esteemed members of the press last week to try and induce them to take on board his Ladybird fictional guide to the policies on this side of the House and lecture us on economic competence. This is the same Minister Dempsey who spent 62 million on machines that only Robert Mugabe would be interested in purchasing.
I felt embarrassed the other night when I watched a population of over 16 million people being able to have the results of their highest poll ever.
In making this point, Bertie Ahern doesn't seem to know that the French, just like the American presidential elections, agree a result based on an exit poll, not on a count. This is agreed by all parties.
85% and have the result out. Have the result out in 2 hours. In 2 hours. And that was only a few hours. That was only a few hours behind what India did with their 1.2 million. And I had to go down to Meath the other day and apologise to the people of Meath that even though we're a modern and technological driven country with one of the biggest exporters of software in the world, that we're going back to the piano.
Now your leader
and that with a bit of luck, our election will be probably finished within about 5 days as we go counting it and checking the bins and the buckets to see if a vote flew off the pile.
Do you make an apology? Do you make an apology? Do you make an apology to the Irish people for the waste of money involved?
If you had taken a mature attitude to a voting system that worked particularly well in the last two elections, The voting worked perfect. All the analysis of the voting worked perfectly. But politically, you wouldn't agree with it, and you took off on a political exercise, getting in a few people from around the world to try and find flaws with it. And I can tell you, it's a disgrace. And any waste of money on the voting system lies at your door. And that's my answer.
Fionnán Sheehan of the Irish Independent.
I mean, it's kind of encapsulated in Martin Cullen's description of the Irish Computer Society is an organisation set up back in 1967. It's a number of computer professionals coming together, and they run seminars and so on. They represent on various different groups. They're so respected that they're a nominating body for the Shannon. They can actually put forward candidates to run for the Shannon. Martin Cullen labelled them anti-globalisation protesters, you know, in the midst of it, because they were objecting and they were raising concerns about electronic voting. So that kind of was kind of typical of the dismissive nature in which he was treating these people, who were basically, all the concerns that they raised were all completely vindicated and validated by the commission last week.
Final comment from Joe McCarthy.
But you're a computer person. I mean, is there a way of designing a system? I mean, are you in favour of the notion? Forget about the hoopla that goes with our tally men and our, you know, laborious counts and the drama. That's something we in radio and television like.
Well, it's a public spectacle. The exercise of democracy shouldn't be a secret.
But casting that aside, is there a way, do you think, that electronic voting can be designed and work effectively for our system?
Yes, I think there is potential for it. And there's a desire for it as well, to help those 1% of people whose votes get mistaken. They make the mistakes themselves in casting their votes. There's a small amount of merit in having a more accurate count. It's fair to say that occasional errors do occur, but after they're recounted, there's almost no error left, and I've been involved in recounts, so I know how carefully the count can be proceeded with if you need to do it. So the question is, why do we need it? That question has never been answered.
Well, to give us quick results, to avoid laborious counts for 4 or 5 days.
Why is a quick result useful, Pat?
Well,
only the politicians
don't ask me that question.
No, the public don't think it's useful, and the press don't think it's useful, and the watching audiences on the radio and the television don't think it's useful.
So what should happen now, Joe?
I think the most important thing to happen now is, there's two things. One, we want to examine how this debacle was created in the first place. 53 million is an awful lot of money to lose, so we have to inquire why, and I've already made some inquiries to see who are these companies, where did they come from, who was behind them, and that's an interesting bit of forensic evaluation. But to go forward, I think the only way forward is to have a completely independent statutory commission to run elections. Not this commission here, which has extremely narrow terms of reference. And in passing, by the way, we need urgently to have the current bill enacted, because the current bill gives this commission privilege. It allows this commission to publish its detailed report. There's a fascinating detailed report waiting to come out here. They did a huge amount of work. They did a very fine job. But to move the whole thing forward, we need to take the running of elections out of the hands of the executive. The executive are interested in being re-elected. Okay. There's a patent conflict of interest if the minister in charge of elections is also a minister of the government wanting to be re-elected. You can't have that in a democracy.
On the general election of last May have just been published. There's Stephen Collins' Neelan's Guide to the 30th Dáil, published by Gill and Macmillan, and the Irish Times.
And the votes were cast as follows.
Well, those are the words which candidates hear with some trepidation. But what aspect of the voluminous archives from the election should one include in this archive programme? Well, I've chosen two compilations, both based on some of the key themes of the election night result and the aftermath, as we approach the question at the heart of every election, who governs next? The disappointed party spokesman had one excuse on election night. They had been squeezed. What this means, I don't quite know. I think essentially it means their party didn't muster enough votes. And as one spokesman insisted on this excuse, it became catching, as you'll hear.
Tonight I'm gonna have myself a real good time. I feel alive.
The following is the result of count one. Cowan, Brian, Fianna Fáil, 19,102.
I think exceed the quota is probably something of an understatement in the case of Brian Cowan. It's a sort of a Willie O'Dea-esque type vote.
20 votes more than Willie O'Dea.
Colin Martin.
O'Dea, Willie.
Sean O'Farrell.
Fianna Fáil.
Fianna Fáil.
Fianna Fáil.
11,438.
8,731.
That's 8,731.
Oh, you wanted to
again.
No good, they want to hear it twice.
9037
And I would, of course, like to thank Enda Kenny because he certainly helped to increase my vote here in Waterford.
1,865.
That, I think, is the end of Joe Higgins.
I've just seen a stunning result in South Tipperary where Fianna Fáil have got two TDs.
I am not conceding. Why would I concede?
All the smaller parties have really, really been squeezed in this election.
But here we are, on Taoiseach. Rumours of your demise were greatly exaggerated.
Yeah.
Squeezed in this election.
Yeah.
Labour just seems to have been squeezed.
Yeah.
Squeezed by the bigger parties.
Yeah.
Squeezed. And squeezed.
Sinn Féin was squeezed.
Squeezed the smaller parties.
The big squeeze.
And we were squeezed.
Yeah.
Some of the newspapers were calling our national media centre Meltdown Manor.
Meltdown, lower dives. If you're earning good money and you're told what you have to say and right, you have to do it, and you don't want to lose your job, and I wouldn't expect any right-thinking journalist who has a very good salary and expenses and to throw it away.
We did our best, and the people have spoken.
The people have spoken.
And I respect their choice as a Democrat. I love my country. I am deeply ambitious for it. But as far as I'm concerned, my period in public life is over.
Good evening to you, Tom Parlin.
Good evening, Sean.
So you're saying the people in the pub there in Vora, they cheered when Michael McDougall conceded he was gone.
Unfortunately, he didn't seek popularity in lots of the decisions he took. And I know that that has cost him his seat and is obviously having a cost on the whole party now at this stage.
Frank Flannery, the Director of Elections for Fine Gael.
To say that the shape of the new government is in any way determined is to jump Beech's Brook three or four times in succession.
In regard to what the Progressive Democrats will do now, how do you see things unfolding?
We're leaving the battlefield now, and the bodies are on the battlefield.
There's also a bit of work to be done by the listener in this next compilation. Dermot O'Hearn, one of Fianna Fáil's outgoing ministers, then and now foreign minister, had in the course of the election characterised the alternative government of Fine Gael, Labour and the Greens. Remember, the Greens' preferred government partners had been Fine Gael and Labour. Dermot O'Hearn repeatedly dismissed such a combination as a dolly mixture cabinet. And his is the voice repeating this refrain in this compilation.
Dermot O'Hearn, the Minister for Foreign Affairs, joins us from Laos.
We have a good record in relation to the environment in Dundalk and in Drogheda, two of the most fabulous recycling centres in the country.
In schools and crime.
Dolly mixture.
If you love her, then you must send her somewhere where she's never been before.
Government.
John Gormley.
That's where we ought to be.
Worn out phrases.
Dolly mixture.
Morning gazes won't get you where you want to go.
Power at the cabinet table.
Words of love.
Dolly mixture. Two of the most fabulous recycling centres in the country.
There needs to be a lot more than just wishy-washy talk about recycling.
Darling, you can kiss another, but save your love for me.
In the national interest.
Won't you save a little loving just for me?
I have to have regard to the national interest. But I hope that the people of the country will also accept that I have to have regard to the future of the Labour Party.
Mr. Flannery and his party want to rely on a dolly mixture of a government.
Life is not always rainbow.
Labour, the Greens or the PDs.
Love is not always rose.
Stranger things have happened in politics. I mean, when Dermot Ahern says that you would be relying on a dolly mixture of independence.
Relying on independence.
That's precisely what Dermot Ahern and Bertie Ahern did in the 97 arrangement with Jackie, Mildred, Harry and...
Dolly mixture.
Words of love, soft and tender, warm weather.
Fabulous, recycling centre.
Wishy-washy talk about recycling.
So the party will have to meet and we'll make a decision after that.
I take that again as a roundabout yes.
You can take it as a maybe, yes.
And that's it for this morning. Next week.
So to our political quiz. This is purely for entertainment. You can compete with other members of your own family. I'll give you the answers next Sunday. So the first question is, who's speaking here and when?
I see this election result as an endorsement of government policy over the past 2.5 years.
And who is this and when?
This was a major gale force wind of change blowing, and there was no way that I could stand in the gap and stop.
Well, that was question two. And here's the third question again. Who's speaking and in what context?
They weren't two left shoes, I mean. They were two black shoes. They were two laced shoes. I think it was somebody with terribly good eyesight who spotted they were two different shoes.
So that was question three. And here's question four. Again, who is speaking and what's the context?
And I remember Powdoddle turned to Tom Kynan. He said, Tom, I don't know whether this television thing will take off or not, but if it does, O'Malley would be good at it. I think you and I can forget about it.
Our fifth question. As the results came in, this was said at which election and by whom?
And you said that an arrangement with Albert Reynolds would be practically unworkable.
Yes, well, I would still stand by that.
And our final question. Who's this and when?
I am not going to comment on the radio as to what I have seen in Leinster House and the manner in which I have known work to be held up, the manner in which I have known deputies to be spending long hours in Leinster House. That's their business, it's not mine. And I have seen over the years, I'm a long time in the Dáil, I've seen young men coming in, elected to the Dáil, and going out confirmed drunkards, and many of them in the poorest possible circumstances.
So, answers next week on this programme. I suppose regular listeners will have an advantage. 2 weeks ago, I promised that on last Sunday morning, we would have more from the archives on elections past. But given the events of Friday's voting and Saturday and Sunday's count, there was a special edition of Morning Ireland last Sunday. But by popular request, and as there's still so much more to be decided on election 2016, here are some further memorable moments from the archives from earlier elections. First, Ronan Kelly's take on the 1992 general election.
It's a very important day for the Labour Party. We've had a tremendous victory in Irish politics, and I hope it is the beginning of major change in Irish politics. Change in Irish politics. Change.
Change. Non-party 60. I have to make a statutory pause to see if anybody requires a recount. Pause over. And I now deem both...
There was a clear and direct movement from Fianna Fáil to Labour.
Dr. Banji.
I'm a psychiatrist.
You'll be needed in Leinster House.
The agony to lot of
the whirlwind.
The agony to lot of
the whirlwind.
The agony to lot of
the whirlwind.
I'm quite amazed.
The Fine Gaelers.
I'm shocked at you to be so disloyal.
Of course, now the Fine Gaelers.
Well, I
I don't see it in terms of disloyalty.
So the Fine Gaelers are describing their vote as soggy.
Maintain solidarity.
This was a major gale force wind of change blowing.
This, of course, is Albert Reynolds.
And there was no way that I could stand in the gap and stop it.
Ben Briscoe.
You know, I often refer to this count as the agony and the XTD. You know what I mean now.
Okay, well, let me just ask you about a comment that you made in the closing stages of the campaign.
I would still stand by that.
And you said that an arrangement with Albert Reynolds...
I would still stand by that.
...would be practically unworkable.
Yes, well, I would still stand by that. Stand by that. Stand by that.
But in the event, the surprise outcome was a Reynolds-Spring agreement, with Dick Spring leading his historically successful party into government with Albert Reynolds, despite what each had said about the other in the election campaign, and indeed in the previous Dáil. Elsewhere in the archives, in the 2002 general election, Fine Gael was led by Michael Noonan. Here's part of the coverage of that campaign, not now the election results, but the campaign, and Miles Duncan is in the chair.
And who knows what Michael Noonan is going to be moving on to after the general election, because according to the pundits, the election is all over bar the shouting, and the only question remaining is, will Fianna Fáil under Taoiseach Bertie Ahern come back with its first overall majority since 1977 in the Jack Lynch landslide? If it does, the future, I would have to say, looks bleak for Fine Gael leader Michael Noonan, who joins me now on the line. Michael Noonan, things are not looking good, really. Are you ready to concede at this stage, even?
Well, you see, that's just a very Dublin idea. Miles, you see, you have to understand that I'm spending most of my time in the country these days, and I'm hearing a lot of things on the doorsteps, you know, mainly screams a lot of the time when I stand there, like, if it frightened them a bit, and the children cry. But other than that, they tell me things that they want a new Ireland, you know. They want the new American Ireland that Fianna Fáil have given, the very fast pace to spending 10 hours a day in traffic. Because if you ask people, where were you for the last 5 years, they'd probably say in traffic.
I think Pat Short might have been involved there as well. But for party balance, Bertie Ahern, then Fianna Fáil leader, also joined Miles that Sunday morning.
Ah, Miles, yeah, hi, how are you? Sorry.
I just say, is it too early to congratulate you on A, victory, and B, the probability of an overall majority in the next Dáil?
Ah, not at all. Not at all, Miles. I believe we will have the first single-party government since 1977.
You have been downplaying that, or at least your handlers have been downplaying that. Are any of your handlers around you at the moment?
Well, I have about, they're out keeping the bus revved up as we're going, because last night I was staying with my cousins down in Cork in Riverstick for 4 seconds, and then we moved on, and it's just a whirlwind tour. And I suppose what I'm finding, Miles, between you and me and the rest of my people who are listening, that... Now, the strange thing with this country is that, a bit like AIB lose 750 million of their shareholders' money, and their shares go through the roof. We screw every single person in the country, and our support goes through the roof. It's just a phenomenon, it's a strange thing that happens in Ireland all the time, and we're winning, because what we have done for this country is that we have got rid of, it was a three-class society, it was a poor, a middle class, and rich, and we've got rid of one of those classes, we've got rid of the middle class. And now it's rich and poor, and I believe it's a good thing.
Back now to a Ronan Kelly take on elections. This is how he looked back at the coverage, the results coverage, of the 2007 general election.
Tonight I'm gonna have myself a real good time. I feel alive.
The following is the result of count one. Cowan, Brian. Fianna Fáil, 19,102.
I think exceed the quota is probably something of an understatement in the case of Brian Cowan. It's a sort of a Willie O'Dea-esque type vote.
20 votes more than Willie O'Dea.
Colin Martin.
O'Dea, Willie.
Sean O'Farrell.
Fianna Fáil.
Fianna Fáil.
Fianna Fáil.
19,732. 8,739.
Sean O'Farrell elected in Kildare.
Stop me now.
Oh, you want it again?
So good, they want to hear it twice.
All the smaller parties have really, really been squeezed in this election.
But here we are, on Taoiseach,
Rumours of your demise were greatly exaggerated.
Yeah.
Squeezed in this election.
Yeah.
Labour just seems to have been squeezed.
Yeah.
Squeezed by the bigger parties.
Yeah.
Squeezed.
Squeezed.
Sinn Féin was squeezed.
Squeezed the smaller parties.
The big squeeze.
And we were squeezed.
Yeah.
Did our best, and the people have spoken.
The people have spoken.
And I respect their choice as a Democrat. I love my country. I am deeply ambitious for it. But as far as I'm concerned, my period in public life is over.
Good evening to you, Tom Parlin.
Good evening, Sean.
So you're saying the people in the pub there in Borough, they cheered when Michael McDowell conceded he was gone.
Unfortunately, he didn't seek popularity in lots of the decisions he took, and I know that that has cost him his seat and is obviously having a cost on the whole party now at this stage.
What may come to be known as the squeeze election, who knows? The still unanswered question, of course, is who's Fianna Fáil's main squeeze going to be?
And in fact, Fianna Fáil's squeeze after that election was the Green Party. But that 2007 election was the last occasion on which the following big names, considerable experience in cabinet and big vote-getters over their careers, stood for Fianna Fáil. Bertie Ahern, Brian Cowan, Dermot Ahern, Noel Dempsey, Rory O'Hanlon, Michael Woods, James McDade, Martin Cullen, Mary Coughlan, Mary O'Rourke, John O'Donoghue, Dick Roach, Pat Carey. Now, all of those stood and won in 2007 election. They either retired, did not contest, or were defeated in 2011. Here's Ronan Kelly's take on the 2011 general election.
Now, if you've just tuned in, you're listening to a Morning Ireland election special. Paul Gogarty, Green Party TD, has conceded defeat.
I would just ask your commentators to stop using inaccurate words, wipeout. This is not a wipeout.
Green Party outgoing TD Paul Gogarty was believed to be in Lucan this morning taking down his posters.
Phil Hogan, Director of Elections for Fine Gael.
Obviously Fine Gael are having a good day. That tonight's gonna be a
good night. The story in Limerick City is that Willie O'Dea is down to 16%. Now, while Willie doesn't do collapse, it's a huge drop for the champion vote getter. Labour's general...
A psalm was read where I went to church last Sunday, 119 verse 39.
Martin Manser, Fianna Fáil, Tipperary South.
Turn away the reproach which I dread because your judgments are good.
Is that a roundabout way of saying the Irish are a very sophisticated electorate, Martin, is it?
The Christian Solidarity Party's Manus McMenamin, very unhappy that his party logo wasn't on the ballot paper and was instead represented by what he claims looked like a picture of nuts.
Burton Joan, Labour Party, 9,627.
And the big story here in Wexford is that the independent Mick Wallace has topped the poll with 17.86% of the vote.
Sean Haughey, 5,017.
No Haughey or Lamass member of the family in Dáil Éireann since the first time since 1927.
Ross Shane, non-party, 17,075.
The Fianna Fáil vote here has collapsed. It looks like neither Charlie O'Connor or Conor Lenihan will return to the Dáil.
Even people whom you actually had done something for, medical cards, God knows what, they still kept saying, we're not voting for you this time.
This is not a wipeout.
Wipeout.
I think, you know, we're going to see a lot of strange things happen before this day is out.
Larry Michael, non-party, 14,104.
It's a bit like Munster playing Leinster in rugby. You take clumps off each other on the field and then get up and pull on the green jersey and play for Ireland.
I think we get the idea. A big triumph there for Michael Lowry.
These are the results of the constituency of Kerry North. Oh, sorry, Kerry South, sorry. It's getting 8 at night.
Flanagan, Luke Ming, 1,701 votes.
Part of the state funding the parties get, and there's going to be have a subheading for group therapy.
I think it's a bit trite to suggest we need group therapy.
What we have to do as a party now is to lick our wounds, and they're fairly severe wounds today. Get back up on the horse.
Luke Ming Fannigan, TD for Roscommon South Leitrim. For the first time, there's going to be a Taoiseach from the west of Ireland, Enda Kenny. He is not ruling out the idea of trying to form a single party government. Might you be of assistance?
Well, I'll have to correct you there. Albert Reynolds was from Roscommon. He was
Rooski, but he didn't represent a west of Ireland constituency.
He was from the west of Ireland. Get your facts right, Sean.
Well, you could say Charlie Hough if you want to get more facts right, but obviously you and I, Ming,
we're going
to continue.
And the following is the result of count one. Adams, Gerry, Sinn Féin, 15,072 votes.
And it looks like we will be in the shakedown for the last seat. However, the fat lady hasn't cleared her throat here yet in Meath, so still all to play for.
I think Owen Murphy versus Lucinda Creighton for the next 30-odd years will be a more cosmopolitan version of Sean Doherty versus Terry Layden above in Roscommon, as we saw in the 1980s.
Michael Smith, Maura Hochter.
You know.
Michael Smith, Michael Kennedy.
It's like Fianna Fáil has been hit by a tsunami.
The Labour Party's on the up, so I had the Gilmore Gale, and I suppose I had a little bit of spring tide behind me, so the tsunami I'd put it down to.
Kenny Enda, Fine Gael, 17,472.
And while I congratulate Fine Gael on being the lead party, you know, I would say, has it really taken you that long? This is not a wipeout.
And perhaps I should say that for those of you who've just woken up and turned on Radio 1, you should be told that you're listening to Bowman Sunday 8:30. This is an archives programme, and comments for the last 5 minutes are all about the 2011 general election. But here's a more recent sketch than 2011 from Willie O'Dea.
Good morning, Fianna Fáil TDs. I'm Willie O'Dea, speaking on behalf of the Micheál Martin camp. When Jack Lynch passed away in the 1990s, it is believed his spirit passed through the sword of Micheál Martin, where it has become lodged today. Who wrote this?
Keep going.
In fact, Micheál is also believed to be the embodiment of Christy Ring and Michael Collins, although not too much of the latter, just the non-blowshirt bits.
Very good.
Among Micheál's achievements are the smoking ban and a rescue mission in Sudan. And is that it? Isn't it after 10 years of
ministry?
That's
very good, Willie. Just keep going. Will you keep reading the script?
A renowned decision maker, Micheál...
I haven't decided whether to keep that bit in yet. I'm not really sure whether we should keep it in or not.
I
can't decide. Just keep going.
So if you cast your vote at all, cast it for Micheál. I'm sorry I ever helped this.
Thanks, Willie. Thanks a million. That's brilliant.
We'll end the politics this morning. We've had many requests for this, and it's a repeat. It's undoubtedly, if my postbag is anything to go by, the most popular campaign song in Irish election history.
Charlie's song will sing as one. Charlie's song will sing along. With Charlie's song will march along.
And next Sunday, as promised. Now for the answers to our political quiz, the voices that you might have recognised from last week's quiz.
I see this election result as an endorsement of government policy over the past 2.5 years.
That was Enda Kenny in 1975, winning a by-election after the death of his father.
I see it as a vote of confidence in myself, and I see it as a vote of appreciation for the work of my late father.
And it was 1975, midway through the Liam Cosgrave-led Fine Gael Labour government. And this question?
This was a major gale force wind of change blowing.
This was Albert Reynolds as Fianna Fáil leader in his first and only general election as leader in 1992. And the tsunami was also known as the spring tide. It was a very good election for Labour and a disappointing one for Fianna Fáil.
And there was no way that I could stand in the gap and stop.
But he still became Taoiseach with Labour after that election. Now who's this and what's the context?
They weren't two left shoes, I mean. They were two black shoes. They were two laced shoes.
Well, this is Joan Fitzgerald talking about her husband and Fine Gael leader Garrett Fitzgerald, who was campaigning in Sligo Leitrim in October 1982, wearing two odd shoes.
I think it was somebody with terribly good eyesight who spotted they were two different shoes.
And the man with good eyesight was local press photographer Henry Wills, who took the famous picture of Garrett Fitzgerald with two odd shoes. Now, who was this?
And I remember Powdoddle turned to Tom Kindly. He said, "Tom, I don't know whether this television thing will take off or not."
This is a young Desmond O'Malley, then a Fianna Fáil TD, remembering how Jack Lynch sent the Parliamentary Party for television training.
"But if it does, O'Malley would be good at it. I think you and I can forget about it."
And who's speaking here? And when?
And you said that an arrangement with Albert Reynolds would be practically unworkable.
Yes, well, I would still stand by that.
Well, again, 1992, and that was Dick Spring, Labour leader, very successful election, and he went into government eventually with Albert Reynolds. Final question.
I am not going to comment on the radio as to what I have seen in Leinster House and the manner in which I have known work to be held up, the manner in which I have known deputies to be spending long hours in Leinster House. That's their business, it's not mine.
This is Oliver Flanagan reflecting on 44 years as TD for Laois Offaly. And he won the seat 14 times, 11 consecutive times winning the first seat. And after he retired, following the 24th Dáil, he spoke of the danger to others of over-frequenting the Dáil bar.
"And I have seen over the years, I'm a long time in the Dáil, I've seen young men coming in, elected to the Dáil, and going out confirmed drunkards, and many of them in the poorest possible circumstances."
Oliver Flanagan concluding our first political quiz. Here's our next one, and see whether you remember this voice and the context.
"No doubt many of you are familiar with an expression in some parts of the country where an outsider is described as a blow-in. Some of these are blow-ins. Now, as far as we're concerned, they can blow out or blow up."
And who is this politician, and what's the context of this comment, and when?
"A combination of arrogance and complacency and blaming the rest of the world on our ills. I think people like the government to face up to their own problems rather than to blame everybody else."
And who is this historian and senator commenting on an RTE television programme lampooning a particular government?
"If you remember the individual depictions of individual ministers, they were described in terms of, not to put too fine a point in it, lechery or greed or begrudgery. You know, the characteristics that were satirised were in themselves very unattractive."
And who is this political leader speaking in College Green, and in what election?
"I viewed the lights of that harbour extend from just being in a clontarf until they went out in one grand circle out to Howth, gleaming welcome to those who come by sea."
And which election saw this leader enter an inter-party government?
"Clona Poblachta is the first real attempt that has been made since the Civil War to raise national affairs out of the rut of party politics and betterment."
Next source is not radio. Radio didn't cover elections, but newsreel sound. Name the leader in the early 1930s and the party.
"I have just tendered to His Excellency the Governor General advice to dissolve the Oireachtas and to summon the new Oireachtas for the 2nd of March."
And those quiz answers next week. We go to our political quiz. I asked you to name the speaker and the context, the date. And here are the original tapes.
"No doubt many of you are familiar with an expression in some parts of the country where an outsider is described as a blow-in."
This is the then Taoiseach, Liam Cosgrave, in May 1977 at a Fine Gael Ó Deis. And he's probably speaking about Cadair Asmal, who had just been the main instigator in the setting up of the Irish Council for Civil Liberties. And what especially irked Liam Cosgrave was that Provisional Sinn Féin had been invited to participate in the initial shaping of the Irish Council for Civil Liberties. And this at the height of the Northern Troubles.
"No doubt many of you are familiar with an expression in some parts of the country where an outsider is described as a blow-in. Some of these are blow-ins. Now, as far as we're concerned, they can blow out or blow up."
Kadar Asmal, of course, was in the country a long time, but was a South African. The next voice, who is this and when?
A combination of arrogance and complacency and blaming the rest of the world on our ills.
Again, 1977. Fianna Fáil leader Jack Lynch on the loss of power by Fine Gael and Labour in that year's general election.
I think people like the government to face up to their own problems rather than to blame everybody else.
And who is this historian and senator commenting on an RTE satirical television programme?
If you remember the individual depictions of individual ministers.
The answer is Professor John A. Murphy talking about the impact of Hall's pictorial weekly.
As you know, Mr. Hall, or Frank as I call him in private, missed no opportunity to give me a bit of publicity on the show.
John A. Murphy's point was that Frank Hall's target was so often Liam Cosgrave and his Fine Gael Labour government.
They were described in terms of, not to put too fine a point in it, lechery or greed or begrudgery. You know, the characteristics that were satirised were in themselves very unattractive.
And who is this political leader speaking in College Green and in what election?
I viewed the lights of that harbour extend from just being in a clantaff until they went out in one grand circle out to Howth.
This is Eamon de Valera speaking for Fianna Fáil, 1954.
Gleaming welcome to those who come by sea.
And which election saw this leader enter an inter-party government?
Plan of Poblachtó is the first real attempt that has been made since the Civil War.
Sean McBride, Plan of Poblachtó, 1948.
To raise national affairs out of the rut of party politics and betterment.
And our final question this morning, from the era of the newsreels, who's the political leader?
I have just tendered to His Excellency the Governor-General advice to dissolve the Oireachtas.
This is Cumann Yéil leader W.T. Cosgrave in the 1932 general election.
And to summon the new Oireachtas for the 2nd of March.
Well, that was perhaps a more difficult quiz than last week's. But regular listeners will have heard most of those sound bites over the years on this programme, and some of them quite recently.